here. We're gathered here today to honor the life of Caleb Gage. The heavens gained a bright new star with the passing of Caleb. He left this loving world, living out his passion for fishing and being on the water. If Caleb was your friend, you had a friend for life. His love for people was truly a gift. The next person he met was his new best friend. And he never knew a stranger. He did everything with passion and zeal, whether it was athletics, work, parenting, or being the life of the party. He was an old-fashioned gentleman from Texas with a southern accent who always said, "Yes, ma'am," and "No, ma'am." And he believed you always opened the door for a lady. Caleb was a baptized believer in Christ and didn't shy away from telling people about God. He had a heart of gold. He was always helping someone move, work on a project, or he was providing some sort of rescue to someone in distress. Many of his friends say he positively changed their life forever by sharing his beliefs. Caleb lived in Arlington, Texas from first grade through his freshman year of high school. He attended Martin High School before moving to Chesterfield, Missouri prior to his sophomore year. He was a graduate of Parkway West High School class of 2008, where he participated in athletics and student activities. After he graduated, Caleb became a certified personal trainer. And shortly after that, he started Gage's Landscaping. He formed many deep friendships and connections in Missouri and Arlington. He would want them to all know that he loved them deeply and cherished their memories together. Caleb's love for his family was endless. He strived to make his own daddy proud and to follow in his footsteps. He was the definition of a mama's boy, and he was proud to admit it. Admired his sister dearly and unconditionally loved his special needs younger brother. His dedication to the care of him was remarkable. Caleb became a father 4 years ago, and it transformed his life. The birth of his daughter, Adeline, changed his life for the better, and he became totally devoted to being a good dad for her. He said she was the best thing that ever happened to him, and all that knew him would affirm he was a wonderful father. And in order that Caleb's daughter will remember her father and how much he was loved by everyone, we invite you to send an email to this address, in memory of Caleb Gage at gmail.com. Please share warm, funny stories and impressions of Caleb. She will be given these emails at the appropriate time in her life. Caleb is survived by his parents, Gary and Carol, sister and brother-in-law, Katie and Cody Malford, brother Colin Gage, and daughter Adeline Gage. Best friend Jesse Schiller, aunts Karen George, Lisa Heising, Renita Paxson, Leslie Dixon, Joni Paul, Julie Netherland, nieces Bentley and Braylon, and grandmothers Marilyn Gage and Sharon George, and many great uncles, great aunts, and cousins.
So I want to personally thank all of you for all of your prayers and support. brother. My family is eternally grateful. I can tell you it's really good to see a lot of your faces and your hugs. It's very comforting. It feels really great to be back in my church home. It's been way too long since I've visited. This place has always felt like a hospital for the broken sinners as opposed to the museum for pretend saints. I think as you get through this memorial, you'll realize that Caleb had the same mentality in his heart when it came to accepting and loving others. I believe that flame was established here. The singing and the song worship here is actually truly special. The harmony is always on point. I always loved when someone chose to be baptized, of course, one, because their soul, right? But also because I knew we were about to sing "Can You Hear the Angels Singing," which is one of Caleb's favorites, mine as well. I'd like to think that's what he heard while approaching the pearly gates. There are some special memories here, and I have to apologize ahead of time for this next one I'm about to tell. And please note that I will be giving a donation to the church when we are finished. So every Sunday, Caleb and I would always volunteer after church to help pick up the communion trays. It shouldn't be a surprise that being young, we were young kids, it was self-serving. Before delivering the communion trays to the kitchen, we would stuff his pockets and my purse full of communion crackers to munch on. Sometimes we would share with our friends in class. So you have to give us that. But I kind of blame my parents for that one because they never fed us breakfast and we were always 15 minutes late. There's the gauges coming in. Stirring a prayer. And I actually still buy those crackers from time to time. It just tastes like home. And the last time Caleb visited my house, he was blown away because I had them. And I guess because he's never shopped in like the kosher aisle at the grocery store. But we snacked on them that day together and we laughed about it, about what we used to do here. My brother was full of fire in his soul. His passion for his family and friends was undeniable. As everyone in here knows, he never knew a stranger. He could make friends with a rock. He would walk by strangers in our childhood neighborhood that I have never seen before in my life, but they knew each other by first name. He spoke to strangers everywhere we went, and you got the truth whether you liked it or not. One of my favorite stories of when we were kids is we were on an airplane on a trip together, and he was sitting with my dad staring down at a heavily obese woman. And we knew exactly what trouble was about to come out of his mouth just by the look in his eyes. And he sincerely asked out of concern, "Hey lady, why are you so fat?" But that mouth and honesty would get him into trouble, but that was what was so raw and genuine about him. On the other hand, he also loved telling stories. My grandparents on my mother's side had a rodeo arena when we were growing up. And when we went to visit, I mostly stayed in the announcer's booth, but he wanted to be down with the cowboys and the bulls. So we would return back to elementary school the following week, and he would tell everyone that he won first place in the bull riding competition, which of course terrified the teachers and principals that my parents would allow such a thing, and his imagination was endless. Being the big sister of my two younger brothers was never an easy task. I was the mother hen, and Caleb was always the one getting in trouble that I had to try to keep out. I spent the majority of my childhood getting him out of trouble and apologizing to the neighbors. Whether it was ding-dong ditching, shooting BBs into the neighbors' windows, or egging Corvettes, he was always into no good. He was 100% all boy and kept everyone on their toes, and somehow he was able to charm himself out of every situation. He loved to explore and be in nature. We would go on adventures through the neighborhood and set up tree houses and camps in the woods with some of you boys that are here. We did it together. And of course, until we got hungry and decided to go home, we couldn't survive living out in the wilderness. But growing up on Lake Arlington is we fished any chance we got because we just walk across the street. But this is where he established the love for the water and where his fishing life all began. if you didn't know, he became quite the fisherman. And it was the love for fishing that he and my husband formed such a brotherly bond. Growing up, he had friends and girlfriends show up unannounced daily. I'd let the boys in or let them go fishing or exploring, but the majority of the time I closed the door on the girls and told them he wasn't home. Big apologies to Catherine, Amber, and Renee. I didn't see y'all multiple times. He would later find out, and would be furious, of course, but I had to try to keep him out of trouble. But Caleb was a charmer from the day he was born until the day he left. He could make any girl blush, and that's why I gave him the name Catsanova. One, because of catfishing, and, because he was a ladies' man. One of his favorite things to do was actually go to my cheerleading competitions, but it was never to watch me perform. In fact, I'm not sure if he ever saw me perform. He was way too busy collecting phone numbers. But he loved making everyone feel good about themselves, not just the ladies. He could brighten your day with his annoying laugh, which apparently runs in the family, but I don't know what he's talking about. And his Tasmanian devil impression, his pterodactyl noises, his sudden outbursts to make sure you're awake, and random songs he would make up out of nowhere. And I felt so silly putting this part at the last memorial, but here it goes. This is one of the songs that we made up together as kids. Kneel, foreign, put them on your cuts, put them on your bruises. And yes, we did that like dance too. I'm not sure if I'll ever be able to use that product again without laughing till I cry. Our relationship was special. From the beginning, he was the annoying little brother that would pester me to tears, and I was the sister that had to trick him into submission or just complain to my mom, of course. I remember my mom wouldn't let me shave my legs for the longest time, and I really only had, blonde peach fuzz. I was very insecure about it. So Caleb started calling me Fuzzy Bunny, and then he told Colin that my new name was Fuzzy Bunny, and then they continuously started calling me Fuzzy Bunny until I was in tears, and I started shaving my legs against my mother's wishes. But we shared the love for sports and always had something going on. When we weren't playing sports or with our friends, we took care of our little brother, Colin. Colin, as most of you know, is autistic, and because of that, he needed extra love and care. Caleb and I shared a strong sibling bond that was strong because of Colin. We had to work together at a young age to ensure his progression and that mom and dad got the help they needed. Being the oldest, I've always had to have this stronger backbone. This allowed Caleb to fully love. I believe he had a heart of gold because of Colin. To say I'm going to miss my brother's caring heart and to help me with the challenges of life is an understatement. We had plans to care for our sibling after my parents passed on. We had plans to raise our kids together. We had so many more plans and memories we wanted to create, so many more concerts and rodeos to attend, more to step in to do, and if he was lucky, I would have conned him into planting another 73 plants in my backyard. Which originally when I pitched to him, it started off as 5 trees, and you can imagine his shock when he showed up at my house, and I had them all laid out exactly where I wanted, and there were 73 of them. I can still hear him complaining when he walked into the yard, he might have called me some names, but I am broken. I'm heartbroken that we will not get to live out our plans, but I am grateful for the memories and the life we had. I know that from now on, there'll be nothing but smiles every time I see one of my plants has a new flower and think of him. Besides being a great friend, a troublemaker, an explorer, a comedian, a ladies' man, and a great gardener, he was a great brother to me. Caleb made it known to myself and to his friends how much he looked up to me, how much he was proud of me, and how much I was loved. If you ask any of his friends, he would say he was proud to be my brother. Josh Leonard recently told me, all of us kids always had a leg up on everyone because we were friends with Katie Gage's brother. And nobody messed with us. And apparently I had a bunch of proud little brothers, as it turns out, which I hold dear to my heart. Growing up, my parents would, of course, allow large slumber parties. My mom wanted to make sure she had an eye on the kids, right? Had that control. So the boys came over to our house. I always tried to escape to a friend's house for the night, and I've been told by multiple guys that there was always a battle on who called dibs on my bed, which is news to me because, frankly, it grosses me out because I know they didn't change my sheets. But I'd like to think that being my little brother gave him the confidence to stick up for the underdog, which he did on many, many occasions. I hope and pray Caleb knew the depth of my love I had for him. I was always so hard on him and set my expectations for him high. I didn't always recognize the greatness in him or acknowledge it, but I really hope he knew why I was hard on him, because I truly loved him and knew he could and would leave this world a better place. I think he did. Unfortunately, it was not until his passing that I fully understood the impact Caleb had on this world. Caleb always had a strong passion for his friends, and at times, it felt like he almost loved them a little more than his family. I now realize that he did not love his friends more, but his friends desperately needed him. I cannot count how many stories people have told me from friends that said that Caleb either saved their life, or was there for them in their darkest hour, or helped pull them out of an addiction, or he was the only family that they had had. I've never been so proud of my brother. And Caleb, bub, I'm sorry it took me so long to fully understand the depth of your heart. I believe God used his heart of gold to help people in his lifetime. I truly think he was a disciple of God and lived out his calling. I pray that if anything comes out of this major loss, it's that all of us, especially myself, can replicate the goodness, selflessness, and love that he showed the world, that we can continue his work of helping those in need and be the light to those in tough spots. And luckily, I share the same blood, so chances are pretty high for me. I'm not sure about the rest of you. Caleb Webster, I promise to continue to make you proud and be a strong for our family. I vow to love and care for Adeline as if she's my own. I promise you will always feel your love and presence through myself and our family. I promise Adeline will know her daddy in the depth of your heart and where she gets her character traits from. I promise her and Bentley will remain best friends, and she will learn responsibility and love through her cousin Braylon. I promise to care for Colin in our old age. I promise to hold Mom tight and make her laugh. Vow to golf with Dad, even though he's got a terrible swing. And I promise to fish with Tony, but I am certain I will never be able to fill your shoes. I love you, Casanova, and I will forever miss you.
Mind by the end of the day, really try to convince Katie to do some fishing with me. Really appreciate that. Coming up here and doing this for the second time, I thought it'd be easier, but it's just as hard. I think I'm a little bit more relaxed because I've seen everything that the family's had to go through in order to kind of get to this point. You kind of like to see the hurt that everyone goes through, and it makes you proud. Your support, and know that it never hurts to give a text message or a phone call, and if you don't get a response from soon, just know that they're thinking about you. It really does mean a lot. I can remember when I was in college, I met Katie, and she was nice enough to invite me up to her house for St. Louis for the first time, and I'll never forget, I was pretty instantly started talking trash to me, right? So I was like, all right, cool, you know. And then, like, of course, like, you know, Katie's mom cooked a bunch, and they were really good hosts. But, you know, I was always trying to stay in shape. And I remember Caleb always coming to the gym with me and us going and playing basketball and working out. And he was always up for the challenge. You know, and that's something I always really. About him. I remember the first time we played basketball, we went and, like, we were playing some guys in the gym, and we already had, like, the edge on them because we had this pride that we were going to, like, come together as really brothers and, like, whoop them, right? And we did. And I can remember thinking, like, after watching Caleb play, that if we ever played one-on-one, like, yeah, I'd definitely take Caleb, you know? So, I remember I come back to visit, and we're in the driveway, and I think we're waiting for everyone to get together or something like that. And Caleb's like, hey, you want to play basketball? And I'm like, here it is, you know. So Caleb lowers the goal so that we could basically poke them. And I didn't have that good a hops in time, but I was about to find out that Caleb did. And it was pretty funny because I'm not the quickest guy or the most athletic guy, but, you know, I've always been, like, decently sized and pretty strong and, like, had somewhat of a skill set. So I remember, I'm like, all right, Caleb, you get the ball first, trying to be fair. And I remember, like, he kind of shook me and took it to the basket. I saw him jump up above the rim, you know, like his eyes were above the rim, and he dunked it. And I was like, damn, I shouldn't have given him the ball first, you know. So I remember, like, the next time, like, you know, he beats me, and I push him at the end just so he misses it. And I remember I got the ball back, and I remember I just, like, had to take it down low on him the whole time. So I'm like, if this dude beats me, I'm never going to hear the end of it for the rest of this trip, you know. But, you know, and then, you know, time kind of goes by, and, you know, Katie and I decide that we're going to get married. And I remember I asked Katie to marry me, and, you know, she relays the news back to Caleb, and Katie calls me crying. She said, I was talking to Caleb, but he said, I didn't have to marry you if I didn't want to. She's like, you still want to marry me? I just started laughing. I'm like, good job, Caleb. You know, like, he's looking out for his sister, right? He wants her to make the right choice, and I don't think anyone was ever going to be good enough for his sister. But, you know, as time would come by, I started to realize that I really gained a brother, you know, like, I thought I was gaining a beautiful family, a strong family, but I gained a brother. And then, then I gained a best friend, and then I gained a fishing buddy. And I can remember, like, growing up, my brother and I, like, we had a job since we were, like, 7 years old, like, every year. Like, we always had a job doing something. And I remember I went to work for this company, and I sold out real hard for them. And I ended up getting let go and being pretty upset about it. And I remember Caleb just happened to come in town. And we're sitting on the back porch. He's like, man, don't rush into your next job. He's like, you don't have to worry about anything, dude. Like, we got you, dude. Like, we'll take care of you. And, man, it feels so good. You know, I'm like, well, I'll figure it out. But just hearing that, you know, sometimes, like, there's words that just touch you. Like, that would mean a lot. So I'm like, that's family. And then spent the rest of that night. I think we stayed up till, like, 2 o'clock in the morning chopping wood. And then he was throwing me the football in the backyard. We were working on, like, putt and kick returns for, like, 3 hours. And we just had a blast doing it. And we were just hanging out, you know. And so finally he and I got to talking. And I decided, I was like, man, I want to buy a boat. It's like, you know, I bought this boat. And I was like, man, I don't know how much I really want to spend on a boat. I don't know anything about a boat. I really don't know that much about fishing, but I got to figure it out. So I bought this cheap boat. This thing barely ran. And we took that thing out on the coldest day of the year. And we had no idea really what to expect, but we were out there fishing and just doing it. And I remember Caleb backing down the trailer, which is pretty hard at the time, a little shorter trailer. And I remember just going up against the current and just listening to Caleb, like, telling me what to do. And I remember just gassing it, going against the current, just turning the boat in real smooth. And that was our first boat launch experience. You know, and found this guy, Catfish Dave. So it was like, oh man, Catfish Dave, we're sending each other YouTube videos and stuff like that about catfishing, you know. And if you talk to anyone that knows me, they know I love catfishing, and that's where it all started, you know. And so, you know, what was really cool about it is, you know, one thing I'll say about Caleb that I always really liked about him was, like, I like to think I'm pretty good at doing a lot of things. If I'm not that good at them over time, like, I can work hard enough at them, I can get good at them. And a lot of those things I was always trying to get good at, Caleb is always right there doing it with me. And very rarely did I ever meet someone that's ever been, like, pretty equal in that regard. So to have someone to go out there and, like, learn how to do it all with you and put in that time and, like, work through the losses and the challenges of it and just try to go out there and figure it out in a place to where it's like, you know, like when we go out fishing, it was just like he and I out there. But, you know, I think God's out there too. You know, I think, like, you really got to get out there and have that quiet time, like that picture right there. That was Caleb's favorite channel, actually. On the southwest side of Lake Conroe, there's this little channel that sticks out below the arm. And you always swear up and down, we always catch fish here, man. We always do. And that's where, you know, we learned a lot. You know, he taught me, he's like, man, you cut the tail off these, you cut them in half. This is the best way to throw the cast net. We had our own little system down. And we would go out there, rain or shine, it didn't matter. And that's kind of like how it evolved. You know, we started off like, when the weather's great, and the conditions are right, anyone can catch fish. But we always wanted to go out there and be able to catch fish no matter what the circumstances were, because we felt like that's what it really took. And that's what I really appreciate about Caleb. You know, it's like, it didn't matter. It didn't matter what the circumstance was. We were going to go out there and do it no matter what the job was and get it done. And yeah, like, I'm talking about fishing, but I think that's the character that Caleb had. You know, he would go out there with you, even if he didn't know anything about it, and knew you didn't know anything about it, and you'd take on the storm with you. I think one of my favorite stories about that was, you know, we went out one night, and it was the coldest night of the year, and I got this video that I pulled up through all this, and I mean, it's pouring cats and dogs, and we were supposed to go out that night, so I sent him this video, like, man, this is the weather, and we just kind of laugh about it. And the next night, we go out there, and it didn't rain, but it was just as cold. We caught the biggest catfish we had ever caught up to that point. And we came back in, and we were coming in. I dropped them off at the dock. I went to throw my keys, and they wet the water. I was, like, pretend throwing them, too. So I remember, like, we just kind of laughed about it. We took an Uber. We get back to the house. The next morning, we come out, and we're at the fishing dock. Caleb's out there hanging out by the boat launch. He's like, y'all catch anything? They're like, no. I was like, oh man, we caught this fish. That was this big last night. So as I got this guy working on the truck, trying to get the key and all that figured out, I just listened to the conversation Caleb had was having with these people. And every time someone else came up, he'd always tell them the story. The fish got bigger and bigger every time. It was pretty funny. But what really, we changed the way we fished after that day, because We met this old guy we were talking to. He's like, hey, why don't y'all try this? And we started catching more fish. You know, and sometimes God does things for a reason. You know, like, throw your feet in the water, go out there. Your brother-in-law just beat himself and then learn how to do something, you know. And it changed everything. Like, man, if Caleb wouldn't have been there, he would have never done any of that. So I think one of the hardest things for me is, we had it down, you know. It's like, we'd go out there, and he got the boat, I got on the boat, he backed it down, he pulled it out, he met me at the dock, we caught some bait fish, we went out there, and then we'd load it up, he pulled it in, and, you know, I'd take other people out there with me, it's not the same, you know. It's like, he knows how to do it, he still knows how to do it. So, anyways, I'm proud of Caleb, I'm proud of everyone for being here. I love Caleb to death, and it's been hard up here. And, you know, what I found that makes me really happy throughout all of today is going in and spending time with those little girls, you know, having Bentley and Ellen around you. Like, there's just something so innocent about them, and it's just like that little bit piece of Caleb that you kind of hold on to, you know. And I will say that the one thing that is always going to last for Caleb and for us something God had to go through himself, right? Like he had to give up his only son. You know, you can imagine the hurt that he had to go through. So, I guess the silver lining is that the stories of Caleb to keep Caleb alive, and we should all be very proud of Caleb. I love you, Carol. I love you, Gary. I love you, Katie and Jesse.
A stirring deep within me. Could it be my time has come? Let us see my gracious Savior face to face when all is done. Hears God his voice I'm hearing. Come away, my precious Lord. Is he calling me?
Caleb was, he was one of my best friends. Caleb was wild and fun and adventurous and kind and mischievous and extremely supportive, and he was, of course, charming. I first knew of Caleb through his sixth grade girlfriend, Amber. She was so proud that she had the cutest boy in sixth grade as her boyfriend. And she would come over to my house, and she showed me a picture of him, comes the first day of seventh grade, and we're standing outside Young Junior High, and she showed up, and he showed up, and she brought him over to meet me, and he said, "Hi, I'm Caleb," and I said, "Hi, I'm Nikki," and he's like, "Yeah, I heard you don't think I'm that cute." And I was just shocked. I was like, I'm never telling her anything again. And he said, "It's all right, I don't think you're that cute either." I was like, "Ah, all right, we're good." And it just so happened that a lot like me and Caleb, our focus was not really on academics. Our focus was more on athletics and social. So we had a lot of classes together, seventh and eighth grade, and even into freshman year, which none were AP classes. So he would ask for my homework, he would ask for everything. But the more I got to know him and the more I loved him and he became my brother, I saw it. I understood why all these girls were flaunting over him and drooling over him. I saw it. I saw the charm come out. I saw the way he would get away with everything. Some of our teachers, I think, said his name more than any other word in the dictionary. But yet, he could still turn in his homework late, and he could still talk in class and not get yelled at. And I just never understood how he could get away with it. Speaking of mischievous, our seventh grade math teacher, he thought it would be funny to tell her that he didn't go by Caleb, he went by Glenn, his middle name. Well, that was the only teacher that he told that to. So the whole year, she's calling him Glenn in class, and we're all laughing about it, and we were walking down the hall one day, and our math teacher was Miss Cooper, and she said, "All right, Glenn, have a good day," and she was standing next to another one of our teachers, and the other teacher said, "Who are you talking to?" And she's like, "Glenn." She's like, "Who's Glenn?" She said, "Glenn Gage." She was like, "You know his name is Caleb," and she said, "Yeah, but he goes by Glenn," and the other teacher was like, "No, I don't think he does." And that was the last time that Miss Cooper called him Glenn in class. She refused to call him that. And even after she knew that she had been played, he still got to turn in his homework late. He still got to talk during tests. I just never understood how he'd get away with it. I wasn't able to be at the St. Louis service, but I did watch it. And someone mentioned the lovely thing that he would do by farting on your head. And if you were one of the lucky few that he picked to do that, and I just so happened to be one, constantly. We had home ec together in eighth grade, and that was a joke. Our teacher would let him do anything he wanted. If he wanted to play hopscotch in class, we were on the second floor, she would let him. If he wanted to go across to a different class, she would let him. If he farted on my head and she heard me yell, she would let him. It didn't matter. He could do just about anything. I would complain that he would bite me in class. He'd always start laughing and then he'd come up and bite my shoulder. And I'd be like, "Caleb, stop." He said, "Oh, Caleb. Oh, Caleb." And that was just the phrase that all the teachers would say. "Oh, Caleb." And I called it like his billy goat laugh. He would be like, "Bah." And God, it would drive me insane. And he would do it so loud in your ear. So as time went on, I loved that boy so deeply. He became a brother of mine. And I became like a sister that he wasn't really threatened by. He didn't think I was going to beat him up or anything like that. None of his friends. I wasn't one of those. So he left before 10th grade, and my senior year rolled around. And my mom asked me, "Who do you want to go to prom with?" And I thought about it, and I said, "Well," she said, "you know, who do you think you're going to have the best time with? And who do you think you're going to have fun with? And, you know, we'll look out for you." And I said, "Well, Caleb, but he's not here." And she said, "Well, if I can get him here, do you want him to take you?" And I said, "Yes." Before I knew it, he was on a flight. My mom had talked to Carol, and they arranged it. just be home in the morning in time to get ready. Because I'm just be home in the morning, ready to get in your tux, and boys got into some tough stuff that night. But he was there in the morning, and he was ready to go. I wouldn't have wanted to go to prom with anyone else. He was the life of the party, always, everywhere he went. If he was there, you were bound to laugh or get into some trouble, or you were just going to have the best time. And I had the time of my life at prom because I was with the life of the party. When he came to stay with us for prom, my mom was a very OCD person. She liked everything in its place. And for the life of me, I could not understand why Caleb was the only one who could leave his shoes wherever he walked out of them. Whether they were in the hallway or in the kitchen or in the bathroom where he was, I kept thinking, Mom, why are his shoes in the living room? Oh, it's Caleb. It's okay. It's okay. And I think, so everyone else has to leave him by the door, but he can just walk wherever he wants? Yes. Yeah. It's Caleb. And I never understood it. And I just thought, you know what? She's right. He's a charmer. He gets everyone. He's the only one that gets a free pass all the time. And my mom thought he was the cutest, even through his mullet stage, which I hated. Even from afar, I would beg him to cut it. He'd always send me pictures. Look at it now. Look how good it's growing. And I thought, what are you doing? Oh, all the ladies love it. I'm like, I don't know what is going on up there, but not here. And I'd show my mom a picture of him, and she's like, oh my gosh, Caleb. Well, he's still a cutie. He's still a cutie. I'm like, Mom, this is not cute. No, he's still a cutie. I was able to reach out to some of our friends that we grew up with that weren't able to make it for being out of town or having to work. I was able to talk to my old best friend, Amber, and she reminded me of a scavenger hunt that she had for one of her birthdays when he was there, and him dressing up as a cheerleader for Halloween, and she was a football player, how he would go to her soccer games to support her, and it got me thinking, yeah, he would come to my cheerleading competitions too. But like Katie, I don't think he was there to see me. He saw me all the time. And just every memory I have of him, even if I was mad at him for that period, it didn't matter. No matter how mad I was at him, I still loved him even more. Because he was a face that you just couldn't stay mad at. He knew how to push your buttons. But I will continue to live my life with Caleb's love in my heart. And I remember when he told me he was having a little girl, I just thought, oh my gosh, are you kidding me? And he was like, no. And I can't be more prepared. I can't be more happy. And from the minute that Adeline was born, he was constantly sending me videos of her. And I tell him, be nice to her. Don't do that to her. It's like, oh, she loves it. She loves it. And if she has his blood, I'm sure she does. I'm sure she did love it. But every memory I have, even the crazy ones, I look back and I'm like, that was Caleb's idea. All of it was always Caleb's idea. But from the moment I met him, well, you're not that cute either. I'm like, all right, we're cool now. This is good. We're on a good page. But I have loved that boy for a long time, for the first day I met him. And it's like the more he drives you crazy, the more you just love him. Because he drove me up a wall all the time. And I always had to get him out of there. Did you do your homework? Yes, I did my homework. Right, let me see it. No! And our math teacher, Caleb, do you need a few more minutes to finish it? Yes. Supposed to bring it done. But he was a charmer. He knew exactly how to talk to women the way that they needed to hear it. And he's just always been a supportive soul. I know not only with me, but my friends that I'm close with, he would ask me, how are they doing? How are they doing? Okay. Well, how are you doing? And everything was always genuine with him. genuinely cared. He genuinely wanted you happy. And he genuinely loved. And he loved you. So moving forward, I will continue to genuinely try to love as deep as he did. Friends and family here. I'm seeing some childhood friends. Man, I've got some friends here from Camp Bandina Christian Camp. I mean, how wonderful is that? I love you, Rhonda and Renee. I've got some friends that have dirt on me, so we're kind of stuck with each other. JB and Neil. You know, I just want you to know that we could not have survived this nightmare without your prayers, without your calls, your emails, your text messages. We wouldn't have got through this, so thank you. Thank you for your love. You know, despite all the news stories that you hear on television and in social media, you know, all we hear is the horrible things and the horrible people. And there's still so much good in this world. There's still so much good. When my son went missing on the Missouri River, not only did we have law enforcement, rescue crews, there was probably 40 to 50 people out there. People who brought boats that didn't even know us, that were looking for my boy. We had, and I bet we had 100,000 people praying that Taylor would be delivered alive. I just want to thank you for everything. There's really no sufficient words to thank you. So let me talk about my son for a little bit. This mama's tired. He was a handful. He was the most charming, loving, and frustrating kid all at the same instant. But he really was pretty lovable. You know, he started at a very early age with this charm thing that Nikki was talking about. His first day at kindergarten, the teacher had pulled up a chair and had an easel with a poster board and a marker, and she told the children, "Now this is your classroom, and you get to make up the rules for your classroom, and we're going to write them up here. So y'all think about it for a minute and let me know what you think the rules ought to be." And Caleb shot his hand up and did this, and she said, "Yes, Caleb, you have a rule in mind." And he said, "Yes, I think the first rule needs to be that we all have to like the teacher." So, you see where this is going. That was it. But you know, he wasn't self-serving. He was genuine. He really did care about people. We moved to St. Louis, which was a hard move for him. I guess at the end of his freshman year. And he, you know, it didn't take him long. He made friends instantly and was loved by everybody. And, you know, he had that little Southern charm thing and the yes ma'am, no ma'am. And, you know, those people ate that up there. But his junior year, he comes home at the end of the year and he says, "Mom," he says, "there's this kid named Mike McGowan. He wants to, or he was an inner city kid. He lived in inner city, St. Louis. And he rode a bus to the school where Caleb was attending, the high school. And Caleb said, "Mom, he's the greatest kid ever. And
he wants to participate in the summer football camp for his senior year, before his senior year. And he said, but they don't have transportation for him to go every day for the football program. And, you know, we really need to let Mike live with us so that he can be part of this program. I was like, okay, you know, this is all new. And he's, Mom, it's the right thing to do. He's a good kid. I said, okay, we'll ask Dad. Well, next thing you know, we moved Mike in with us. And we watched this bond develop between Caleb and Mike that was just precious. And it was two totally different worlds that bonded. And Mike, I know you're in St. Louis listening to this. I just want you to know that I love you. Our family loves you, and Teresa and your family. And Caleb loves you with all his heart. And we're so blessed, Mike, that you came into our lives. And it was because of Caleb. Caleb did this. So thank you, Mike, for being part of us. You know, like Nikki said, he had a charm about him, and when he was in high school, he went to work for this car wash, and he was always bringing home pies and cookies from the car wash, and so car washes up there are a big thing because there's so much snow and ice and, you know, salt they put down, and so people buy these memberships, and they just go through, and Caleb had a slew of little old ladies. I mean, we were all gaining like 20 pounds from, I told him, I said, just quit bringing it home. Leave it up there, you know. But they loved him. They really did. They loved him, and he took good care of them. And, you know, he would always run over to the car and open the door for him, and all the other guys were like, what's he doing, you know. But that was who Caleb was. You know, he started his little landscape company, and he became very close with all his clients. You know, he wasn't just the guy who showed up mowed. He, you know, he hung out with them and that sort of thing. And I remember I called him one day, and I said, what's going on? And he sounded a little flustered, and he said, Mom, I can't talk right now. He says, I've got one of my little clients, and I'm rushing her to the veterinarian. He said, I really think her dog has had a stroke. And I was like, okay. And he goes, yeah, I'll call you later. I said, okay. So, well, the little dog didn't make it. And he took her home and called her family and stayed with her for like 3 hours until the family could come and be with her. And I thought, what a sweet boy. You know, this little old woman, that's all she had was that little dog. And he really did care about people. He really did. He had a good heart. It was a proud moment for this mama. Caleb was a champion for the underdogs of the world. I think some of that's because we had, you know, our own challenge. He defended the weak and the disabled and the oppressed. Sometimes got himself detention because he got in the middle of stuff he shouldn't got involved in. You know, I think it was in the fourth grade over here at Ditto Elementary. He had a classmate in his class that had a lot of problems, a lot of some mental problems. And sometimes this student had violent incidents happen in the classroom. And the teacher grabbed me one day and pulled me aside, and she said, I just want to tell you, this has been heavy on my heart, and I owe you an apology. And I was like, well, what's this about, you know? And she said, well, the student had a pretty major outbreak, and I mean, was throwing chairs, you know, and she managed to get herself and the other kids out of the classroom, but Caleb stayed in there. And she said, I watched your son, and he was able to connect with this person and was able to calm this person down and special. What a gift. What a gift. And I told her, please don't apologize. You know, if that's what Caleb felt compelled to do, then that's Caleb. You know, he had a gift for gab, and it was very, very social. You know, here we attended this church, and when we were first visiting, I think he was about 5 years old, and he was always getting mad at us if we left too soon after services. You know, he's like, we're supposed to be shaking hands, we're supposed to be talking to people, you know, and we're trying to get to Luby's or whatever. And anyway, so he would just get really mad at us for that. And so it was real funny one day, we were visiting with people, and I was talking to someone, and he just kept, you know, how kids, mom, 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 mom. And I said, what? What do you want? And he had dragged this real cute little blonde teenage girl over to me. And he said, Mom, this is Mallory Ellis, and I want her to be my babysitter. And of course, she was like, oh, he's adorable. Yes, he is. Yeah, so y'all may have heard this story. I couldn't leave it out, but, you know, he was just a handful. And when he was in elementary school at Ditto, he ended up on a behavior chart. You know, people just love their children having behavior charts. You know, and he wasn't really necessarily bad. He was just mischievous. But, you know, one day he was having a really bad week. We were doing the behavior chart, and we were running late to school. We pull up from school. He goes, oh, Mom, he says, you gotta sign my behavior chart. And he whooped it out, you know, and he was just trying to kind of hide it so I could sign it, you know. It was red. Red marks on every line. Every box was just a big, fat red, you know. And so I'm just screaming at him. I'm just screaming at him in the car, chewing him out, calling him all kinds of bad names. And he sat there, and he took it, and he just listened, and he, you know, just went on. This ranting went on for a while. And I said, then get out of here, and don't you come home with any red marks today. None. Or you are going to be in for it, you know. So he gets out of the car, and he starts to shut the door, and he opens it back up, and he looks at me and says, Mom. My best girl. Get out. That was my boy. Yeah, it was my boy. Caleb was a very loyal friend, fiercely loyal. He had a lot of buddies, and you know, a lot of his childhood friends have reached out to me with messages and stories, and they've posted stuff on social media. I know a lot of his childhood buddies are at a bachelor retreat right now, and I got several messages from them. And I just want to say to those young men, Caleb loves you. He always loved you. I love you. And you still owe me money for all the food you ate in my house. But I want to thank those boys for reaching out. They're special boys. I have to mention one young man by name. This is going to be hard for me to get through. Keegan Lee. Keegan lives here. There he is. Keegan and Caleb grew up together. And as soon as Keegan heard that Caleb was missing, this boy got in his car and he drove all night long to get to St. Louis, showed up at the river, and he searched for my boy high and low. there's some boys hurting right now. You know, Caleb was a mama's boy, and that was a gift to me. Sometimes drove me a little nuts, but he was mama's boy. You know, when he was in elementary school and started going to school, if it was raining outside or a storm while he was at school, he suddenly got a sick stomach and needed to go to the nurse. And he would call me, and as soon as he heard my voice and that I was okay, and I wasn't out driving in the storm, and his stomach was better, and he went to his class, and he was okay. One story that I'll never forget was Caleb had left St. Louis and gone down to College Station. He was going to go to Blinn, and it was real hard. I went down there about, I guess he'd been gone 3 or 4 months, and I drove down there, and Katie was living in that area at the same time going to school. And we arrived at Caleb's apartment complex before he got there, and we were kind of standing out in the parking lot, and we saw his car coming, and he zipped in, and he parked, and he jumped out of the car, and he ran into my arms, and he was crying, and he was holding on to me, and we were just having this wonderful moment, and Katie's over there going, "This is ridiculous." She says, "Seriously, Mom, cut the umbilical cord." Katie was like, I don't care what you say, I love my mom, you know. So those little moments mean a lot to me. I'm gonna miss my boy. You know, just a few more things. He loved family reunions. What teenager loves family reunions? You know, he complained we didn't have enough. And his spirituality. I tell you, Caleb didn't always walk the walk he should have walked. But I'm going to tell you something. My boy was out there telling people about God. And I didn't know how much until I started getting all these stories from his friends. There were so many that said, "I believe in God because of Caleb and his testimonies." You have no idea what that means to our family to hear those stories. Are you going to talk about the story about Julie? Got a letter from a mama, Julie Aliano, up in St. Louis, and her son was Jacob. She sent me this letter. She said, because Jacob worked for Caleb for a short time with the landscaping company, and Jacob was down a dangerous path. He was making some really bad choices for his life, and long story short, Caleb had to fire him. And he set Jacob down and he told him, "Jacob, you're going to have to make some choices here because you're either going to have to, you're at a fork in the road." And he said, "You're either going to have to change your life or you're going to die." And he just told it like it was. He said, "You're either going to have to change or you're going to die." And for some reason, Jacob listened to Caleb, and Jacob enlisted in the military and is a decorated Marine now. And when he heard that Caleb had died, he called Julie and he told her, "You tell Mrs. Gage that Caleb changed my life. I wouldn't be alive right now if it wasn't for Caleb. I don't know that I've ever saved anybody's life, but my boy has. And I'm so proud. I'm going to shut up now. We're all hurting. My heart's shattered. My deepest ache is for his little girl who's going to grow up without him. She was his world. He told me not long ago that he wished he was a wealthy man, and I asked him, "Well, yeah, don't we all?" I said, "Why? You know, why?" And he said, "Because I could just stay home with my daughter 24/7. I think about her every waking hour. She says, I just want to be a good dad. Anyway, I'm determined that this little girl is going to know who her daddy was. So, I believe we mentioned it before. If he has stories or memories of Caleb that you'd like to share with his daughter so she'll know how much he was loved, we'd sure be grateful. Thank you again for being here. Your love and your prayers and your support mean everything. Hold on to your loved ones. Love your babies. And I pray you never have to bury a child. And God bless you all. Thank you.
Better known as Caleb's dad. Caleb got around a lot more than I did. Been some great stories. I have a few. I hope you'll bear with us. But, I wanted to start out with a little greeting and some thanks. Many of you have been over to our house, 2807 West Marquis Circle, I think it was, across the street from the lake. And you walk across the street. The lake to the west. It's kind of a neat place, flat place there. We play baseball or football or whatever. And slough of the Missouri River. The Missouri River itself can be somewhat treacherous. It fluctuates a lot in depth and speed. It's got a lot of underwater wing dams or wing dikes, as they call them. And so it's a bit treacherous, but not where he was. He was in a little slough between the mainland of Chesterfield, which is a western suburb of St. Louis, and what's called Ellis Island. And you walk over and you start walking down, and there's what used to be a causeway connecting the islands. It's washed out somewhat. And it was fishing with his buddy Josh that night and in a canoe. And watching the sunset, and again, the sluice itself is very placid. Over the causeway, there's some water flowing, maybe, you know, look like about 3 feet high or so. But the undertow, somewhat unpredictable, and they got a little too close and fought it, and tow pulled them in. And again, you would look at it, you wouldn't think it would be that dangerous. Carol saw it when she visited the spot and said, "This is what killed my son. I got sucked in, the water hit the canoe, flipped it over. Josh was able to get out about 30 to 50 yards downstream. And some fishermen had seen the accident, called in, and the search began. And when people were notified, this girl said there were literally thousands of trailers that we were notified of across the country. And I want to thank you, everyone that prayed that we could find him. There were so many search and rescue volunteers. Of course, the authorities were out there with their infrared, with their sonar boats, with their drones and helicopters. And the response from the community and the kids was unbelievable. The causeway, or what was left of it up on the shore, was full of volunteers waiting for direction. And people showed up with boats. Kids filled the boats. We filled the boats. People came up, as Carol mentioned, from Texas. Some flew, some drove all night to be there to help with the search and rescue. And so it was. Everybody combed the shores, and prayers continued. Folks showed up to augment the state rescue. Got in boats. We went further down the river from the authorities, just expecting to hear Caleb wave and say, "Dad!" Yeah. Hopefully he's just injured, right? A couple of days later, we got the bad news. But I want to thank everyone that showed up, and just the outpouring of prayer and hope for everybody up to that time. But after we get the bad news, and the condolences came in, the text, calls, posts, food, offers of support, it's been unbelievable. Packed house in St. Louis to remember Caleb. That grown man calling me crying because, and not knowing what to say, who does? But all feeling empathy, knowing, you know, what they would feel if you lost your oldest son. You know, just a feeling of future patriarch of the family. Whoever's going to extend care on him. Brought this to Sina. I'm prepared. Someone to extend or carry on the family name. But all, you know, being there to be the especially thankful for the story you shared with Caleb. The verbal stories, emails, texts, posts, the personal stories you had with Caleb and his personal impact on you and on the circle. Those are the most heartwarming things that have uplifted the family. We thank you so very much.
I'm already wet, I think. I don't know if I'm in tears or spilling water and have makeup all over me, but I'm going to forge on.
Thank you guys again for being here to remember and honor Caleb. Our family appreciates it. Carol, Tony, Katie, Jesse, Colin. So many people traveled from far away. California, Colorado, Georgia, Missouri, attending yet another memorial for Caleb. Good to see so many faces from the formative years. Faces I remember as being cherubic, right? But now you're grown adults, and I still call you kids. When I say the kids, I'm still talking about 30-year-olds here, most likely. You guys that slummed around my house, like Carol said, and busted yourselves up on our driveway skateboarding and pounding the basketball till all hours of the night in the driveway, sneaking out Katie and Caleb and Colin's windows upstairs and climbing around on the roof, creating mudslides in my backyard, killing all the grass anytime it rained. Thank you all for being truly blessed. We have, and I will share some stories on Caleb and our love for him. I ask that you please pray for the family. Pray that, we hold those memories dear and we focus on those more so than what we could have or what we could have. Because what we did have was special. No, not everyone knows what to say. And oftentimes that's how people reach out. We don't know what to say. It's okay. Just being there. Just saying something. Just showing your love for the family. For my son. Thank you for it. We're just very humbled by your love and generosity. I'm going to talk a little bit about Caleb also. We didn't do very good about comparing notes, but for the most part, we're not going to tell the same stories. And I'll start at the beginning, maybe not all the way back to the very beginning, which was probably the first night Caroline and I had alone since Katie was born, and in a hotel in downtown Austin. But 9 months later, we had Caleb. And coincidentally. And, when we had Katie, we thought we maybe wanted a boy first, but I'm so glad we had a girl because they're so much more nurturing. And as we found with the boys, there's a bull in a china closet, right? And, we needed that nurturing soul first. But unlike many of you kids today, you have the gender parties. I don't think those existed back when we were having kids, right? In fact, we didn't even want to know, really, until they were born. So, the very moment that Caleb was born, of course, I saw his, he came out, saw his future manhood there, and said, "It's a boy!" And Carol and I hugged and cried, and, our lives were never the same. He was born in the hospital just in Rockwell County, first baby of the year, of the decade. And so, there's no social media or anything like that back then, of course. People actually read newspapers to get information, and about five of the communities first new baby of the year with a check pictured, which I think had the wrong date on it, and then all the toys that he had been gifted and so on. And so and it was weird that somehow Caleb was in some of the pictures by himself, but instead of Caleb and Carol and me and the other pictures, it was Caleb and Carol and the knucklehead doctor. So I never knew what that was about, but anyway, I was a little bit stiff-armed on that one. But anyway, you know, Caleb, people say everybody knows Caleb. St. Louis area, and Caleb knew everybody, and I think maybe that was a start, right? He got his start in 5 different newspapers. We moved from that area, went to Cincinnati. From there, Albuquerque, came back to the Woodlands, and then to Arlington. All that by the time Caleb was probably 4 or 5 years old. But in Cincinnati, you know, nobody had any fences. And, you know, Caleb was howdy-doody, even, you know, from a wee hike. And so he would see neighbors outside. He'd go over there and visit. But he achieved some notoriety around the neighborhood simply because when he'd go outside, which where he preferred to be, he also preferred not to wear clothes. And, you know, he'd walk over to our friend next door, Dave, and I remember one time Dave said, "Caleb, oh, almost didn't recognize you without your clothes on." I mean, with your clothes on, but after clothes on. So anyway, you get it. So when we moved to the Woodlands, when Caleb was probably about 4 years old, and you know, he'd already started that connecting with people, find out what they're doing, talk to them, kind of thing. And Carol and I were new in the neighborhood. We were walking the kids one day, and some lady stops us. She said, "Oh, hi, you must be Caleb's parents." It's like, you know, 2 cul-de-sacs down. And, you know, he's a little kid. I mean, this is not a commentary on our bad parenting. It's just that Caleb got around. And we're like, "How do you know Caleb?" "Oh, well, he came over the other day and helped me plant some flowers." "What?" And we see and hear and have heard, even over the last couple of weeks, many stories. We had some idea of the generosity, his tendency to engage, to help. But some of the stories, I'm going to read some of them, are pretty overwhelming. Of course, as a little guy, he was super cute. He cracked me up all the time. Kind of had that sense of wonder. Every meal involved into a discussion of the food chain. Cats eat dogs, does tigers eat, you know, monkeys, does T-Rexes eat people, and all those kinds of things. And he always had all these animals around. And to talk about that, and this is kind of a quick side story, but we were had the local pool there in the Woodlands, and all the lifeguards knew Caleb, right? Especially, you know, the cute female lifeguards, because he made himself known. And one time they're blowing a whistle, everybody evacuated the pool. What's going on? Well, you know, they evacuated the pool every now and then, just, you know, so everybody can rest, etc. But everybody had to get out. And so I looked over there, and all the lifeguards are gathered around, and they're looking down. And look down what they're looking at. The lifeguard's up on top, and she's up on the chair, even, that's elevated by them, pointing down. And I'm like, "What is that?" I see something on the ground. Caleb walks over there, picks it up. It's a snake. And he lifts it up, and then she says, "No, Caleb!" And it was a fake snake, of course, that Caleb had brought. But anyway, so Caleb cleared the pool at age 4. You know, he was just a boy, man. He was always wanted to wrestle, and he always wanted to be subjected to the claw. And he'd laugh till he couldn't breathe, and you'd stop. And then he'd come back for more and laugh until he couldn't breathe. You know, always being flipped or thrown around or playing Super Caleb and so on. He was a good baller, a basketball player, even at an early age. Tony talked a little bit about his balling skills. But I'm telling you, when he was a kid, I've never seen anything like it. He could dribble with both hands just down the sidewalk. swords and gun. He has Scooby-Doo underwear, and he'd always tuck them in like he was a Scooby-Doo Terminator or something. You know? And look, you'll see pictures. You got to look closely. That's what he's got, swords and guns in his underwear. He continued to grow as an athlete. He was, as I said, a good basketball player. When he was in the Y League here in Arlington, he often scored about two-thirds of the points in each game on his team, of his team's point. And I remember one time, I mean, he would take shots, layups, I mean, whatever, it didn't matter, long shots. One time I remember him seeing crossing the center court line well before the three-point. You could see him pulling up, starting to shoot. And I literally just jumped on my feet, and I said, no! And then it went, swoosh. And he was good. But that was Caleb. It was always an amazement, a surprise. We didn't know he'd be that good. That little, he won the city of Arlington free throw shooting contest. I think it was put on by the Elks Lodge, somebody like that. And he had made like 23 of 25 free throws from the normal, free throw line, even though he was probably only far better than, two or three age groups above him. Of course, he won his age group. We talked about the fishing, of course, in elementary and high school. He'd regularly fish across the street with his friends, with me, by himself, with a 70-year-old man that used to come up there that became buddies with him. Grizzled old guy, beat-up truck, but that's where he always wanted to fish. They got to be buddies. He would give Caleb bait. He even came to the door once. Carol told me, hey, is Caleb here? He's wanting Caleb to come out and play and throw the net for him. It was young and old alike that talked about Caleb. I don't know how many grown men came to me and said, oh, Caleb, he's a great kid. He'll be all right, kind of thing. He loved the outdoors. Besides fishing, he mentioned skateboarding. Basketballing, we had a boat in Lake Arlington. So many of you guys out there took you on our boats. He did a lot of tubing and kneeboarding with the rest of the kids. He enjoyed shooting the BB guns, killing the mice that were going in between the timbers in our, in our walls. Anyway, it was a good thing that he loved the outdoors because he was a destructive force of nature, and you didn't want him indoors. Somebody talked a little bit about his imitations, and it was amazing. I mean, he could imitate Elvis. he did that at a very early age, super cute. Chewbacca from Star Wars, and we're all Star Wars fans in the family. And he sounded just like Chewbacca. He did it all the time. And Katie mentioned pterodactyl. Louis Armstrong, What a Wonderful World. Go play the song today and think about Caleb, because Caleb sounded just like Louis Armstrong. What a wonderful world. Unbelievable. He could regale his friends with his ability to express bodily gas on command from either end, which, of course, was a big deal and made you popular, a source of hilarity and fun at that age. Played sports with many kids out here. He did a Rangers, Bears. At young junior highs, like you said, from... was here about from the first grade till the time he was a freshman, through his freshman year at Martin. And he was a bit of a ham. I don't know if we have the pictures, but we can remember him playing baseball. I don't know if it was T-ball or when he just started baseball, but for whatever reason, he got to run home from third base to home, and instead of just running in like he's going to slide, he's running waving to the crowd. Anyway, I could go on. There's no way that we can do justice to all the stories that I could tell. But later and recently, as mentioned, he became a dad to a little girl, Adeline, and she is like him in so many ways. I mean, even as a little thing, she would, 2 years old, walk into a room and just smile first thing in the morning and start laughing. I'm not a morning person. She walk in and start laughing. Like, what are you laughing about? She's just happy to be here, I guess. And Caleb was You know, in recent history, I think it's perhaps as a result of that, he became, you know, a little more interested, spent a little more time with family. You know, we played racquetball, golf, fish, the driving range, skeet shooting, those kinds of things that we both enjoyed. But I think more than anything, he was becoming a more mature son, a man. And, you know, with him I could discuss politics, religion, sports, family dynamics, kids. I think more than anybody, though, for a long time, he this is the most important item, but he would laugh at the stupid dad jokes, because I think, you know, he was at the point where he got it, you know, and, I'm listening dearly. So I'm going to read some testimonials here in just a moment, but a couple of quick stories. He got around. People knew him, but he was very unassuming about things, and I shared this story in St. Louis. You know, a couple of quick stories. One night we asked him, well, what were you doing last night? He says, oh, I was over at the casino hotel. What were you doing there? He said, there was a party up there. How can anyone your age afford a party up there? He said, oh, no, it was my friend's dad. Friend's dad, well, why would they invite you? I said, well, what kind of party was it? He says, well, it's for the St. Louis Blues, you know, NHL hockey team. What? You were there? I said, well, what were you doing there? He said, oh, I was just hanging out with, you know, TJ Osi for a while, which is rookie of the year hockey player for a lot of folks that don't know. Anyway. And he was always surprising us with stuff like that. We had no idea, and we wouldn't have known. We wouldn't have asked him. One time, he got a call. And he said, hey, Oz, oh, no, I can't do it tomorrow, you know, maybe the next day, you know, whatever. Who's that? He's like, well, it's Ozzie Smith. What are you talking about? You mean Ozzie Smith, the all-star baseball shortstop of the St. Louis Cardinals? Hall of Famer? Yeah. How does Ozzie Smith have your phone number? He says, oh, we hung out a little bit. Oh, why were you hanging out a little bit? It's like, well, you know, went out with this, you know, a friend of mine, and Ozzie's got two daughters, and, you know, a friend of mine and me, we went on a double date. You know, what? You went on a double date? I hope you guys behave yourselves, right? And he's, yeah, we're waiting on the girls forever, and Ozzie's just kicking back into the, you know, recliner. We just hung out for a while. Wow. Anyway. So, very unassuming in that regard. It was just, you know, it didn't matter who you were, rich or poor, famous or not, race, religion, you know, he would approach you, he would engage you, he would show you care, he would show you love. I'll read some postings that have been actually very comforting to us from some of the kids. As an example of what we've been talking about. Ted of Gage, I'm so sad and heartbroken that you're gone. It doesn't seem real. You always had a way of making me feel so loved and cared for. Knowing that I didn't really have much family, you took me under your wing, checking on me and making me feel less alone in this world, and gave me great advice and always had my back when I was dealing with pretty difficult situations. Once in a while, we'd be there randomly at the same time at the gym. You'd come over to me, you'd smile on your face, give me the biggest hug. It can make my whole week 1,000 times better. I just, when I saw you a couple of weeks ago, there wasn't a last goodbye. I'm going to have to skip through some of these. Because of all. I hope that you knew how much you and our friendship meant to me. Please watch over us all. Rest in peace, my sweet friend. That's from a young lady. The first time I met Caleb Gage, he was this jack new kid from Texas asking a trainer about creatine and testosterone boosters on the first day of sophomore year football camp. While my friends and I laughed, the two of us weren't good friends immediately. It wasn't until after he threatened to beat my butt in a bathroom at Parkway West doing an admittedly distasteful comment I had about one of his friends that we broke the ice. We became close after he graduated. good-hearted, always admired kid with good-hearted, carefree charisma, his old-school work ethic, athletic prowess, and daredevil demeanor. I wanted to be as cool as him, but as fiercely loyal as a friend, a dangerous, unpredictable enemy, a man in all senses, through and through. And I deeply respect these qualities about him. It's not an exaggeration to say that I believe in God today directly because of experiences I have ahead of Gage. I consider him one of my oldest and closest friends. There are few people in the world that have ever known me as well or as long as he has, and now there is one fewer. Despite his early love of the occasional fist fight, Cato brought people together more than anyone I know. Having him as a friend was equivalent to having the phone number and address of anyone in your city or current general proximity that you knew or even remotely heard of. Not only would he know them, he'd know how their grandparents were doing. It's unfathomable to me how Cato managed to connect with so many different people. Where do you even find the time? His raw talent and potential was infinite. He was larger than life type of man to me that I looked up to, despite being 6 inches taller. And while he may be gone in body, for as long as I and many others live, he won't be far from mine. I love you, brother. Legends never die. Now, let's see. This is a touching one from a young lady. We knew about it. We just didn't know the depth at which he helped this young man and with cancer and his girlfriend later to be wife. She writes, this one hurts extra. There are a million and one things I could say about Caleb Gage and his friendship to Jimmy and I, but this story is a perfect example of his true love and dedication to his friends. When Jimmy was sick and hospitalized, I had to return back to work. I didn't want to leave Jimmy alone. Of course, my first thought was to call Caleb. He instantly said, I'll be there ASAP. Parentheses. Caleb sat with Jimmy all night long in that hospital room. I just wanted someone to keep him company for an hour so that Caleb stayed. They both fell asleep that night until I returned. And when Jimmy couldn't go in public or be around germs, he and Caleb fished some more, no matter how bust Caleb was. When we told Caleb we were going to be getting married, he cried. He was so happy. When he said we were starting IVF to try to get pregnant, he cried again after trying to give us literally every dollar in his pocket. When we met him to tell him we were pregnant, he bawled his eyes out. Caleb has been a huge part of mine and Jimmy's relationship, and I don't think we'll ever fully get over the loss. We're so grateful to have been able to call him a friend. I hope to raise my son to be half a man. To be half the man this guy was. He did it each day by the saying, give a man a shirt off your back. As we read more and more posts about his passing, it's so obvious how much he meant to so many. Love you, baby. Caleb Gage was such a kind of, this one from a young man. Caleb Gage was such a kind and loving soul with the heart of a lion. I think he is where they got the phrase, man, give you the shirt off your back. Everyone knew Caleb for the kindness and joy he brought to the world. He was always the kind of friend you always were glad to have in your corner or on your team. I can't think of one memory where seeing him didn't bring me joy. Seeing the outpouring of support made me realize that I wasn't the only one who felt this way or knew the impact he had on all of us. When he spoke with you, he made you feel like you were the only person in the world. He had such a vigor for life and a magnetism about him. Always full of energy, his stories always grabbed our attention, and his laugh and voices were infamous and infectious. Could ever hope you rest peacefully, dear friend. I love you, brother. I miss you forever. And there's some more recent ones here. First time I met Caleb Gage was actually in detention. Caleb was in there begging the detention teacher, Miss Walker or whatever, to go on a date with him. And when she said no, he asked her to the prom. Talk about a guy that knew how to set the tone and make anyone laugh. I'm so glad me and him remained friends all this time. I've never seen the guy say no to anyone, no matter what it was. I don't look at it as a life lost, but amazing person that will never be duplicated. Love you. I love you, Caleb. This is a young lady. He went to church with us. I love you, Caleb Gage. You are a brother to me, always looking at you. Made me laugh to tears. You told me like it is. So much love, especially when I needed to hear it. You taught me how to drive. It was totally your push that brought about my confidence. I'm so grateful to her I could be Sunday to celebrate your life, especially since your service is literally in the building where we met. What a trip. I'm still in such a wave of process, and I'm sure I'm not alone there. It's so hard to grasp that you're physically gone. I'm only glad that it happened. While there is a mutual love so much, I know there will be many fishing trips under honor. From building houses together in Mexico, you coming by for many nightcaps of chocolate milk, the memories I have of you, Ivania, I'll continue to share them. Your smile and your laugh will never be forgotten. After some reflection, I'm realizing that in many ways you influenced me as I definitely looked up to you. Thank you for being my brother. Thank you for being at one point in my life my best friend, and thank you for believing in me. Your love for life, for your friends, and for your beautiful family will never waver. Your one-of-a-kind heart lives on in every single one of the people whose lives you touched. There's so many more to read, and I'll probably read a couple more. But, As I read these, it made me think of a song that I just heard years ago. It was sung by a group that was just, so powerful and strong. I'm just going to read abbreviated few lines because what I thought about Kevin, especially after reading the stories, these are the words that came to me. The song goes, there's a candle in every soul. Some burning brightly, some dark or cold. It goes on, so carry your candle, run to the darkness. Seek out the hopeless. And the confused and the torn, hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle and go light your world. So carry your candle, run to the darkness. Seek out the lonely. Tired and worn, hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle and go light the world. This young lady writes, heaven gained an amazing man this week. To say knowing and being friends with Caleb was a blessing is an understatement. No words will ever do justice to the incredible person he was. Caleb, you will truly be missed. May your light keep shining, your soul live on in the lives of everyone who knew you. Rest easy, my sweet friend. Thank you for your
say about their loved one. I was Caleb's youth minister when they were here in Arlington, and I tell you, they left an impression. That some people go through life not knowing what to do or what they want in the moment. And some people just ride the wave of life and never come out of their shell to be extraordinary. And Caleb was not one of those people. He went for what he wanted. The story when Carol shared about choosing your own babysitter and getting the hottest girl in the room to do that, I mean, my first thought was you could do that. I wished I could go back and get somebody to be more like Caleb. You know, whether it was sports, work, or being a father, Caleb worked to be his best. And he moved to be close to his daughter, and that changed him. That's an inspiration in itself. While the rest of the world works to make themselves happy and not take the role as a father seriously, Caleb made it his goal to be the best father that he could be. I was told he once said, "I wished I could be rich so I could spend every minute of every day with my daughter." What would the world be like with more fathers like him? Some people need rescuing in life, but Caleb, turns out, was one of the rescuers. He was there for anyone that needed him. And I want to just read something that Amanda Dunlap, Singleton at the time, wrote to me. She said, "Caleb had a heart of gold. He was absolutely hilarious and had the most contagious laugh, but most of all, he was genuine and kind. Everybody knew Caleb Gage. He was real. Never fake. If there was a party, Caleb was at it. If Caleb was anywhere, it was fun and always a good time. He was always the life of the party, super social butterfly. He would give anyone the shirt off his back. He was the most amazing father to his sweet daughter and best friend you had ever could ask for. He was one of a kind." And she tells the story that what he was like to him, that Caleb always checked in on me, always. "I knew if I called, he would answer. When I lost my husband unexpectedly, 1 year ago, the 17th of this month, I called him, and he answered. He always knew what to say to calm me down and level me back out. He checked on me frequently since then. Fast forward to December, Nikki's mom unexpectedly passes away, and she was a second mom to both me and Caleb. So, of course, Caleb calls often to check in on us like he always did. He was a true lifelong friend. He is already so greatly missed." Caleb was the friend that someone needs when they needed him. His door was closed to no one. And at the memorial service in Missouri, when it was learned how many people got up and told story after story that it was Caleb that rescued them, one person said, "How did he have time for all of this?" You see, people knew what Caleb was doing by helping others, but no one knew the extent of it. That shows a genuine heart. He did things not for the recognition, but because it was the right thing to do. And most important, several told stories of how they wouldn't even know God if it wasn't for Caleb. You know how honored I would be if just one person showed up at my funeral saying, I wouldn't have known God if it wasn't for him. I would walk away of life in saying that I fulfilled what I was here to do. And Caleb wasn't even a full-time minister. He was just Caleb. Caleb had more than one that said those kind of things. And he wasn't He wasn't one that went around just telling everybody about it, but that was what Caleb did. He inspired. He inspired people to be more. One of the ways that he inspired me was how he and his family were. I've had a lot of brothers and sisters come through my youth group, but none stand out like Katie, Caleb, and Colin. What's strange is just 2 weeks before this happened, my wife and I were talking about them. We were talking about the impact that they made and the love that they showed one another. It was something that left an impression on you. Your family left an impression. You never forgot it. And that speaks to a lot to the kind of parents that they had. You don't see people like that without seeing a great set of parents behind them. The responsibility of a parent is to teach their children what's important in life. And Gary and Carol taught their kids how to love. And we see the impact of that teaching today. One friend that wants to remain anonymous said to me, he said, he can make a lifelong impact on the people he meets within minutes. He is loyal to his core and would do anything for his people. Caleb teaches you through actions how to be a true friend. He starts the party, is the life of the party, and is the last to leave. He was always down for a good prank or fart competition. It seems to come up a lot. Caleb never met a stranger. Even in elementary or junior high school, he talked to everyone and made everyone feel included. Caleb was very competitive, not necessarily with others, but more so with himself. This not only pushed him to be a better person, but it pushed everyone else to be a better around him. Caleb became this person because of his family. He loved and laughed hard because that is how Carol and Gary raised him. The Gages are the most welcoming and inclusive family there is. If Gary and Caleb were going fishing, you could bet they were inviting you along for the ride and wouldn't regret it. You know, when we have family members like that and we lose them, it's something that we all have to face at some point or another. We want to hold on to our family members. We want to hold on to the ones that we love. We want to protect them. We want to keep them. But life doesn't work that way. Tragedy strikes. And naturally, sometimes we feel abandoned by God. We start asking questions, where was God? Why, God, did you allow something like this to happen? And I just want to focus on these words that Jesus said on the cross. He says, my God, why have you forsaken me? And here he's quoting Psalm 22. And something I think a lot of people, they read the first verse, why have you forsaken me? That the psalmist is asking this question of why? Where are you, God? Where are you? But a lot of times we don't read the rest of the psalm. Because it turns out that this psalm is a psalm of hope. It's a psalm of victory. Because in verse 24, it changes. He says, for he has not despised or scorned the suffering of the afflicted one. He has not hidden his face from him, but has listened to his cry for help. And then he goes on claiming that he is going to shout it from the mountaintops what God has done. And he is going to talk about the victory that we have in God. And this fits what Paul was saying in 1 Corinthians 15. Says the last enemy to be destroyed is death. Later in that same chapter, he says, when the perishable puts on the imperishable and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? And I think of situations like this, that someone young is Caleb, that Caleb has faced his last enemy. And he claims victory over it. Life with God isn't about getting everything right. It's not about living the perfect life. It's about growing in God. And not only was Caleb growing in God, he helped others do the same. He reached people that someone like me couldn't reach. That's inspirational. So as you mourn not getting to see or talk to him every day, I want you to remember it's only for a little while. And I just want to read this poem and we're finished. It's a short little poem called The Chain. You may have heard it. It says, we knew little that morning that God was going to call your name. In life, we love you dearly. In death, we do the same. It broke our hearts to lose you. You did not go alone. For part of us went with you that day. God called you home. You left us peaceful memories. Your love is still our guide. And though we cannot see you, you are always at our side. Our family chain is broken and nothing seems to be the same. But as God calls us one by one, the chain will link again. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for people like Caleb, putting people like him in our lives to make the impact that he has. And Father, we thank you for working through him, and Lord, for guiding him. And Lord, we pray that we take his life and we take it to heart to know that we never know when. But to live every single day, to be an example, to make an impression on people, to make a difference. And Father, thank you for doing that through Caleb. Lord, we pray that you help all of us go out of here stronger for knowing Caleb, for having Caleb in our lives. And Father, we just pray that you strengthen us. Strengthen the family as they get through this. And Father, bring your hand, your comforting hand, and comfort the family in a way that only you can. We thank you for everything that you do. We love you. Please take care of Caleb. On behalf of the family, I want to thank all of y'all for coming out today. In a moment, we're going to have one song sing. During that song, it's going to be allow the family to go ahead and get up, and they're going to be heading over to the West Foyer, and we encourage you to go by there and sign the book and leave some stories for his daughter. So thank y'all very much, and y'all can go ahead and sing, and family will be dismissed, and then after that, everyone will be dismissed. Thank y'all.